Okay, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the third session of Synoikis Digital Classics Summer Term 2020. Today, we have an introductory session to talk about Synoikis Digital Classics, which is running from 2014, I have to say. And this session is especially for students. For those students who are participating for the first time in Synoikis, and so they can know what is Synoikis, this what we have been doing, and the program. And Dimitar Ilyev is with me today from the University of Sofia. Dimitar has been contributing a lot to Synoikis Digital Classics, also for the two past courses in the fall and in the spring, and also for this semester he's helping us to develop the program and to teach sessions. So as you know, so Synoikis is on StreamYard. If you want to join our Synoikis Google groups, you can get more information about every session, the class outline, and other things. Otherwise, as you know, and probably some of you is already on YouTube, you can follow our sessions on our YouTube channel. And also more information is in GitHub. Anyway, I will start by sharing my screen. I will show, give me 1 second, so I can share the entire screen. And then I can begin by showing you something about Synoikis. So I think that now you can see my screen. And I also hope that the StreamYard is working on YouTube, because I can't check right now, but I started the broadcasting. Okay, so Synoikis originally was a program developed in the United States by the Center for Hellenic Studies of Harvard University. And this word, Synoikis, is an ancient Greek word, basically meaning an alliance, okay? And is an ancient Greek word used by Thucydides. And the original idea 20 years ago was to develop courses in ancient Greek and Latin in order to help students from different universities in the United States and colleges join these courses and follow a wide variety of courses. Then a few years ago in Leipzig, in the Digital Humanities Department, we decided to contribute to Synoikis, developing a parallel Synoikis for teaching the use of digital technologies for ancient Greek and Latin. And this is the reason why we have this program called Synoikis Digital Classics. And in the screen, you can see the web page of the original program of the Center for Hellenic Studies. So basically, Synoikis is a consortium, an international consortium of many universities, not only now in the United States, but also in other countries, in Europe, but also in Brazil and in other Eastern countries, contributing to the program. So the idea is to have different courses every academic year devoted to the application of digital technologies for studying and researching ancient Greek and Latin sources. And now the program is running from 2014, when we began to develop it. And you can find more information. We have, of course, a page, as you can see here on the website, a page at the University of Leipzig with information about the course, affiliated institutions, and then main other information is available in our GitHub pages where we have a complete description of the program, as you can see here, such as Noikis is Digital Classics, which is an international consortium of digital classics programs, and you have information about well, the origin of the program. We also organized a few years workshops and seminars for gathering faculty members from different countries in order to begin to develop the program and build syllabi for this course. And so we originally began in 2015 with the first course, which was held in the summer semester 2015, and we had a long course involving different institutions. Then, from the academic year 2016-17, we began also to include other courses for the winter semester and the summer semester, and then from the academic year 2017-2018, we have been offering three courses, one in the fall or winter semester, then another two courses in the spring and in the summer semesters. And we have this possibility because we are collaborating also with the Institute of Classical Studies in London, so that we can offer three courses. One of the big challenges of Sunoikis originally was to combine many different needs, of course, of students and faculty members, but also different academic calendars we have, not only in different continents like the United States and Europe, in South America, but also in different countries, for example, within Europe, where we have very different academic calendars. But now we are managing this, and this is also the reason why we have three different courses. The fall course or the winter course follows the academic calendar in London. Then we have a spring semester, which begins at the end of the winter and covers part of the spring, again following the semester in London, and then the so-called summer semester, which is this semester following the German academic calendar in Leipzig, starting in April. Today is the first day, and going through July. So this is what we have been offering. And in this page, you can see links, basically, to these different academic calendars. Sunoikis is, and here we have, we can also see Sunoikis in the GitHub repositories. Before presenting what we have been doing, I have to say that Sunoikis is today possible because we have many technologies, and this is the reason why it's easier today to develop such a program. And especially this year and this semester, where we have this crisis due to the coronavirus, well, we hope to offer a good service, and we know very well, because we started now a few years ago, how digital technologies can help universities, institutions, faculty members, and most important of all, students, to go on with their programs. And in fact, in Sunoikis, we are using different technologies for developing our program. And one of the first goals we have is to involve students following our sessions, but also producing data, basically, technology. Sunoikis is a course for the application of digital technologies, which means trying to produce, understand data, historical data, for ancient Greek and Latin sources, and how to produce new data. This is the reason why we have GitHub repositories for every academic year, where we can upload data produced by faculty members, then teaching materials, and possibly also data produced by students. And another important thing is that Sunoikis is an online initiative, as you can see, because we gather online every week, but our faculty members, they work separately at their home institutions to help students follow this course. So we have one session every week, every Thursday, where we present, we introduce many guests working on different aspects of digital classics, and then we have other people, other professors, instructors working at their institutions in parallel and using Sunoikis to help students follow the course. And this is something that I'm also doing in Leipzig, because Sunoikis Digital Classics is part of our program in the Digital Humanities, and the same also for Dimitar and for also for other contributors who are part of these semesters. So in this page, okay, as I said, we have for those interested, especially for the students who are new to this program, you can find information about the reason for this program, the goals of this program. And I'm saying that because Sunoikis is specifically devoted to digital classics, by which I mean the study, the research and production of data for ancient Greek and Latin sources. But we have a mixed audience, because we have not only students in classics, so specifically studying ancient Greek and Latin, but we also have students in computer science, computational linguistics, and I know that because I teach in the Institute of Computer Science in Leipzig, and so we have also students interested, even if they don't have specifically a background in classics, but they are interested in learning more about the application of digital technologies to historical data. And so this is why our resources offer a description of the course and other information to help students from a different background. And so if you jump to the GitHub or as our website, you can find then also basically links to the different academic calendars. I think, going to, I think I can describe maybe, I can briefly talk about let's start with this semester. Okay, usually you have we have for every academic year we have a wiki, we have a page where we collect information about the three courses that we are offering. And for this specific academic year, this is our wiki, where you can, first of all, you can see the tools that we use, and also the institutions involved specifically, because we have, of course, Sunoikis is in Leipzig, and now we have also the contribution of the Institute of Classical Studies. And then we have a Google group, Sunoikis is a Google group, as you can see here in this page. You can join this Google group if you're interested in the program. The Google group is important because it's a place where you can ask questions about the program, and you can get answers if possible, but you also get information about each session, and you get also links to StreamYard. For example, if you want to join the session and participate in the discussion, or otherwise a link to YouTube where you can follow the session. You can also ask questions through YouTube, or otherwise you can follow the session later, because every YouTube video is in our repositories, and so you can follow the session and use our videos anytime you want for your personal interest or also in your classes. Materials, Synoikis Digital Classics materials, including slides, videos, etc., have a CC license, so you can reuse these materials. You have, of course, to attribute these materials to Synoikis and to our contributors. And in fact, also here, you can see that we have a Synoikis Digital Classics YouTube channel where you can find the videos of our session since the first one that dates back at the beginning of 2015. Okay, these are the resources. We are using StreamYard because we can live stream our sessions, so they are automatically recorded on YouTube. In the past, we used Google Hangouts, but now this service is not anymore available for live streaming. And the idea, StreamYard allows the participation of up to 10 people, which is also our goal in the sense that Synoikis Digital Classics is not a massive online course, is not a course where we want to have a big group of people online. Basically, our sessions are panels with a restricted group of people discussing a specific topic every week. In any case, through our YouTube channel, you can ask your questions, and then we also have our Google group for participating in our activities. And so this is the thing. Basically, if you're interested in joining Synoikis, join our Google group so that you get every week information about the session, the time, and the topic. And then in this page, you can see that we have three links to our three courses. And for this academic year, 2019-2020, well, we have first a course in the fall, Synoikis Digital Cultural Heritage, which was a course developed chaired by Valeria Vitale and Gabriel Boudard at the Institute of Classical Studies London, which is the institution developing Synoikis together with Leipzig. And for example, here you can see that in that case, you can open the page and you can find the complete syllabus for the fall, where we had 9 sessions, always on Thursday, concerning different aspects of digital cultural heritage. In this case, we follow, the title of the London program, where they have the digital cultural heritage program. As you can see here, so the thing is that for every week, we have a class outline, and the goal is also to try to invite more people in each session to talk about a specific topic, so that we have lectures, but the idea is also to promote a sort of conversation, among specialists, teachers, instructors about specific topics. And you have not only the syllabus, but also a sort of reading list concerning basically digital cultural heritage, and here you can find these resources. To give you an idea, each session has a specific page, a class outline, which is something like that. In this case, I selected the first session of the fall semester, where you have precisely everything, the date and the time of the session, the link on YouTube, and then we give specific details about the topic. So you have the slides. After every session, we always upload slides that you can use with a video or also separately. And then you have a description of the session. We always include seminar readings specifically for the session, further reading if you're interested in expanding the topic. If is possible, also an essay title, because we have people interested in assigning an essay for students. So sometimes you don't find the essay title like in this case, and then we also include, if possible, exercises concerning a specific topic, because the idea is to use different tools that are now available in Digital Plastics for helping students produce data. And we also have the possibility to publish in Synology this data produced by students, and we also have a few reports of students in different countries about their work in Synology. Okay. And the important thing is that these all these things are available, so we keep them in our repositories. So, you, for example, you can still access the material for this specific session. You can follow the video on YouTube. You can also use it in your classes, and this is especially for teachers in their seminars or for their lectures. They can include our videos, and then you can use our slides, and then we have usually many links to different resources like platforms online, data, methods, and then of course many readings. We also try to keep everything updated, but please you can email us if you find something that doesn't work, or if you have new resources. Well, so basically this is the structure of every session. Every session has the same structure, of course, different contents. And as you can see, in the case of the fall semester, we have different topics. Originally, the idea at the beginning of Synoikisis was to focus on a specific topic concerning classics, and then using different technologies. Then we realized that it was difficult because we really have many people contributing to Synoikisis with many interests, many different expertise. And so after the first year, we decided to focus more on the technologies, okay, to see how we can use the technologies and how they are developing for dealing with historical data. So this is the reason why sometimes when you read for the first time the syllabus of a Synoikisis course, you can feel a bit lost because immediately probably you don't see a coherence. But the thing is that we focus on the technologies, okay? Technologies we have now, and every one of us, those who contribute to Synoikisis, have been working a lot in developing these the technologies, in producing new data. We always try to add these new things. And even if maybe we repeat the same titles for this session, the effort is always to keep up to date with new data, new problems, issues, questions concerning digital classics. In the case, for example, of this fall semester, which was about digital cultural heritage, we have sessions, as you can see, about digital images and photography, 3D imaging, which is a topic requested a lot in Synoikisis, also because we have specialists in this case. Then we have digital gazetteers. We have a lot of work today in digital classics for geography and for geoannotations. Linked open data and linked ancient world data is definitely an important fundamental topic today for dealing with the data of the ancient world. And then also legal and ethical considerations, crowdsourcing cultural heritage involving institutions, for example, like the British Museum. So this is to give you an idea of some of the main topics of Synoikisis. And then we had, going back to this page, spring course, again chaired by Gabriel Bodar and Dimitar Iliev, who is with me today from the University of Sofia. So they developed this program for the spring semester from January through March. And again, we had other 9 sessions. In this case, the idea was to talk about other aspects of digital classics. As you can see, for example, Wikimedia sites for research, which is today an important thing. How can we use these Wikimedia resources for digital classics? EpiDoc, which is a subset of the TI, especially for inscriptions. And we have many sessions about EpiDoc because we have a lot of work in this sense, and mainly do a lot of new data. Introduction to Python, as you can see, we also try to talk about programming languages for historical data, and specifically ancient Greek and Latin. Tree banking, in this case, definitely an important component of Synoikis is constituted by linguistic annotation, because we have today data guidelines for performing morphosyntactic annotation for historical text, historical languages in Greek and Latin, and we have many contributors who are expert in this sense and who have been producing a lot of data. Translation alignment also, and textual alignment, where we have tools developed in Leipzig, and then also data visualization. And again, also for this course, we have sessions with the same class outline. So as you can see, in this case, the focus was more on markup languages, one session, of course, about Python, but we have other sessions for Python in the previous academic years, and then mainly linguistic annotations and translation alignment. And now, well, we have this semester, we call it summer semester, following also the name of the Leipzig semester, the Sommer semester, and we start today and we will go through July. So we have more weeks, 14 weeks in this case, so we are following the Leipzig academic calendar. As you can see, so we have in the end three courses covering almost the entire academic year. And it's good because in this way we can help different institutions with different academic calendars. Because of course Synoikis has a program, but it's also quite flexible, and the flexibility is due to this fact, because our goal is to be a program, an international program, okay? And so this is the reason why we're offering really many sessions, and we have now really 100 sessions. So this semester, again, I'm working on the program with Dimitar Iliev, he's helping me, and we have, so the idea is also to spend some time this semester to talk about teaching digital classics, because of course this is a current question, because we are really in a special situation today in the entire world, I have to say, and so many people, including myself and also Dimitar and other colleagues, are working a lot in using digital technologies. We have a great experience thanks to Synoikis, but of course our audience with Synoikis in some way is limited because we are dealing with a specific field. Of course, managing an entire semester in an institution with online technologies can be challenging. We have many tools today, but of course it can be challenging. And so the idea was the opportunity of this difficult situation is to try to talk, to discuss also about teaching digital classics in the sense that how can we deal with this discipline. And I think that at the end of this semester, which is definitely very challenging, challenging for both for teachers but also for students, we will get a great experience in this sense. So even if the situation is difficult, I think that we can get the opportunity to learn new things, okay? Also to develop more online resources. And so this is the reason why also next week we will have a session talking about digital classics, but the idea is also to address this problem in other sessions. For example, we will have a session on May the 7th about open access for digital classics, which is which will be a discussion about accessibility, which is a well-known problem, especially in a situation like this, where accessing resources can be more difficult. Then this semester, we will talk about other aspects. For example, we are working on two sessions concerning text-bearing objects, basically inscriptions and manuscripts. We are working on these sessions. These are sessions that you can find in different semesters of Synodicesis, because the reason is that we have a lot of material in this sense, and we are producing new data every year. Then Synodicesis, as I said before, is focused on ancient Greek and Latin, but we also try every year to involve people working on other historical languages that are very, very important and fundamental also to understand classical civilization. This is the reason why, for example, we have a session about Persian, and especially Persian speakers learning ancient Greek with specific technologies, because we have a PhD candidate in Leipzig from Tehran working on these aspects. And also in the past, we had a different sessions on Farsi and also on learning ancient Greek, for example, for Persian speakers. And we also had other sessions in the past about Arabic. So the idea, of course, is to go beyond specifically ancient Greek and Latin, and including other historical languages. Okay, then we will talk about, we'll address topics like name entity recognition, which is part of data annotation, data citation with the canonical text services, which is a specific protocol for producing canonical citations for classical sources. Then we will talk about linguistic resources, textual analysis, which is also part of this. Then we will have a session, programming for humanists, which is a session we had also last year. And I have to say that we had a lot of fun, because the idea is to try to, not only to teach programming languages for humanists, but to try to analyze, okay, programming languages, and try also to translate them in a natural language. So this is a very interesting interesting session. And then we will have also a session about prosopography, Greek and Latin prosopography, in this case in inscriptions, with Rada Varga, who has been contributing a lot also to Synodicesis. So this is to give you an idea of our topics. Again, the idea is really to present different technologies for the study of ancient Greek and Latin. A question that I have, because I know that there are students without a background in classics, and this is especially for my students in Leipzig, who have been following the course also in the previous academic years. Well, the language, ancient languages are not specifically a requirement of this course, in the sense that we always try to, we always provide translations, and we always focus on the technologies. This is important. Of course, we use as examples and as problems and questions classical sources, but we present them also for an external audience. Okay, and this is also why students without a background in classics can begin to understand problems concerning historical data. How can we represent them in a digital environment? On the other side, students with a background in classics, students who already know classical languages, they have the opportunity to learn computational problems. Okay, how can we represent classical sources in a digital environment? So questions concerning how the machine works. Okay, so I think that, basically, this is, I can stop sharing my screen. I talk a lot. And so the idea was to give you, a brief introduction. I don't know if Dimitar is with me in the session. I don't know if you want to add something.
Yes, I would like, I don't know if I'm heard well.
And yes.
I also see that we have another participant, a guest participant here in our session. Well, that was quite an exhaustive presentation of the course and the idea and what it's all about. While I was listening to it, I just want to add several things. There are several aspects of this. First, when I remember it, as you said, it all started as some sort of a common effort on a common topic. I think this was after the example of the original American synoikises. We tried to produce the first year. We tried to produce results connected with a certain passage of Thucydides, which was read by different countries and in different ways. So this is an experience which was and still is well worth it, and the results are there for all to check. And also, it's a good opportunity to compare teaching and learning methods in the different countries. Every year since its establishment, because the faculty encompasses people from 15 countries or even more, as far as I know, ranging from Germany, the UK, the US, Bulgaria, Georgia, Croatia, Italy, and many other, Brazil, not to forget. So across several continents, and everybody comes up with their own experience and their own method of teaching and method of presenting sometimes same or similar problems, which probably is good for between us to make comparison of what we're doing, and also for students to be exposed to different types of presentation of problems and methodologies. So this is something quite valuable about it, and maybe it's also interesting for the students who are following the course. And we have about now we have collected a quite large archive of materials on a range of topics which is constantly developing, but is more or less the same. So we have a lot of sessions and a lot of different approaches on things like TI, XML markup, EpiDoc, or more broader, text alignment, tree banking, corpora, Python, and things like that. So I think that for now we have accumulated quite a lot of teaching materials or on the same topics which can be used, reused, compared, and I've also been thinking about somehow encompassing them in some sort of a reading list by topic, because from 2015 until now we have really a lot of different materials. And the thing is that each material is not only a teaching material which can be followed, but also presents a lot of opportunities for individual or teamwork to each topic in the curriculum. Every semester there is a reading list which is left for the students, for those who follow, to elaborate, to get acquainted with alone by themselves, and also some hands-on exercises which can be done individually or in teams, so which could be quite challenging because for many of them there are no ready-made answers. Last semester when we were doing for example the most recent thing which comes to my mind, when we were doing Python or tree banking, there were some programming tasks which students could try their hands on, but nobody could guarantee that you will follow a certain pattern, you will get the certain result, but you learn how to do things by doing. So maybe it's no big deal if you don't succeed the first time, but you can take your time and repeat it at another point, because the materials are there and they're staying and they're building upon each other. So if the first or the second sessions are a bit hard to follow, then by the fifth, you're more into the problematics of the field and the specific approaches. So you can go back to what you were doing, and you can apply your accumulated experience in the meanwhile. So more or less, yep, for now, this is what I have to say about this.
Yes. Okay. Well, yes, Dimitar, of course. I totally agree with you. And also, yes, you mentioned the first year we had, where we started with two CDDs, also because there was a group of people, including myself, reading and studying a lot of CDDs. So we tried, we started also with one of our main interests. And it was, it worked very well, but of course at the time we had many requests from other people expanding the program. So this is the reason we abandoned that idea, but in the sense that we experimented more on focusing on technologies. But this is something that definitely we can try again in the future. Maybe we can find a big topic concerning, of course, a language or a period of time, or an author, a text, a corpus of text. So there are really many possibilities, and in this sense we are open to various ways for developing our program, with a focus, of course, on the digital component. So, and every year we try to find new solutions. Of course, we also look for help, because we are now really a big group of people, but we can't cover everything. Okay, so I think that is enough, I think, for today, because we covered everything. Again, this session was not about a specific topic first, because we had the need to present the course to new students. Also considering that this semester is difficult in this sense, that we are doing online teaching, but we can't be in the class. And so we couldn't really be with the students and helping them to start Synoikesis. So this is the reason why we are offering this introductory session for our students, because we are at home, or if we are not at home, we can't be in the class together with the students. Okay, so this is the reason why we skipped this a topic for this session. But for next week, we will start with our program. So we have our sessions where we have roughly 60 minutes of presentation, and then we have about 15 minutes for questions. So from 5 p.m. to 6:15 p.m. Central European Summer Time. So remember that. And before the session, in any case, our sessions are already on GitHub. You can find the class outline. We try to put everything before the session, so you have the topic, readings, and then links, in this case, okay, to the YouTube channel, and then we also upload slides. Maybe due to the current situation where we have more work, because we have to use technologies help us, but we need more time for arranging everything everywhere in the world. So maybe we can be a bit late. But anyway, every week we have a session, and with a lot of material. So I think it's early, because it's 5:45 today, but I don't think we have to add other things for today. We don't have questions in the chat for today.
I'll check it.
Yeah, I think the only thing is that, and I apologize, I probably sent the wrong link to YouTube in our Google group. And so YouTube is working. I just edited the session on GitHub, where now you have the correct link, and I apologize for that, because YouTube is working, but originally in the email in the Google group there was a wrong link. Also because the passage from Google Hangouts to StreamYard sometimes generates these problems. But anyway, this is Okay, in fact, now...
Yeah, I would like to add that every time the current session is running is on the main page of the YouTube channel. So if if you get confused, you just click on the main Synoikis DC page and you see the session which is currently going. You cannot miss it, but yeah.
Exactly. And in fact, now I see the first hello in our chat. Anita Ferreira from Brazil. Hello, Anita. I know that you lost the first part of this session because there was the wrong link in the Google Group email, and I apologize for that. But combining many different tools, also because we are using other platforms. In the past, we had only Synoikis online. Now everything is online, which is fantastic, I have to say, because we have experience, but we have to combine really many different web platforms. Okay, so I think it's everything for this session. And a note for my students also in Leipzig. You have also information in Moodle. Okay, so just in case in our Moodle in Leipzig, in any case, you have the description of the course, and every week you have the link to the class offline where you find everything for joining the session in StreamYard. And I encourage students to do that, even if we have a limited number of places, because I think it's up to 10. But anyway, so now, this is a small course, I encourage you to join us sometimes to participate in the discussion. Otherwise, we have the YouTube channel. Yes, Anita, thank you very much. Yes, Synoikis is always alive. And this year, considering the difficult situation we have, I think it will be a nice opportunity, a great opportunity to experiment with technologies and to learn a lot. It will be challenging, especially for our students, because I understand that especially connections can be difficult. So we know the problem, but we try also to offer the service through Synoikis. Okay, I think it's everything for this session. So we will meet again next week, 5 p.m. Central European Summer Time until 6:15. So we have 75 minutes. Everything is online and we will update everything.
Yeah, but, this is like 4 o'clock UK in Portugal and 6 o'clock Sofia, Helsinki, Warsaw and Athens.
Thank you.
Be sure not to miss it, because I tend to get confused about these time zones. But yes, 5 o'clock Central European Summer Time.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Dimitar. Okay. So thank you, everybody, and see you next week. Have a nice week and a nice weekend. Okay.
Have a nice week.
Bye. Okay.